started, I want to thank you all for coming tonight. We are meeting this evening in conjunction with the exhibition Jack Lenor Larsen at 90, Transformations by a Textile Innovator. We're really excited to welcome our panelists here this evening. And before we get started, before I introduce our guest curator, did anybody lose this? Does he recognize this? It was up in the gallery? No? Okay, well, we will put it out. We'll put it in Lost and Found. And if you remember that you lost it later on, that's where it will be. I'm Lynn Nelson Mason. I'm the director of the Goldstein Museum of Design, and I want to thank you again for coming this evening. I also want to thank a couple of our sponsors of the exhibition. I just want to make sure I get everybody correct. For Counten and Tout and KDR, we're excited to be able to feature the works of Jack Lenor Larsen and hear a little bit more about working with him this evening from our panelists. I want to introduce now, though, our guest curator, Stephanie Zollinger, who will be our guide this evening and will introduce the panelists. So, again, thank you for coming.
So, good evening, everyone, and thank you again for being here. And it's an honor for me to present our panel tonight. I'm going to start right here with Lotus Stack. Lotus is the former textile curator at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. And we have Krista Stack right here, who was the former director of design for the Larsen Design Studio. Next, I want to introduce Ellie Karanauskas, who was the former vice president of sales and national sales director for Jack Lenor Larsen Incorporated. Last but not least, I'd like to introduce Lori Weitzner, who worked as an independent textile designer for Jack Lenor Larsen Incorporated, where she created many of the notable collections. So if we could give a round of applause to our panelists. And what we're going to do this evening is each panelist is going to spend about 10 minutes talking to you about their role in relationship to Jack Lenor Larsen. And once they do that, then we'll open the floor up for questions and discussion. So, Lotus?
Good evening. I thought I would set the background here and give you some idea about what the Larsen Archive is, which the exhibition in the gallery upstairs is based upon. Can you hear me, or do I need the microphone?
Left thumbs up.
Okay. The archive is very large, and it gives us the ability to truly understand how multifaceted the Larsen Company was, and in turn, what textiles are about. So it's a wonderful teaching tool because it gives you insight to so many areas that, for students here, will have to be able to be familiar with to be successful in the field. As I said, it's very large, and it's housed in three different places in the Twin Cities. It's housed here. Part of it, the textiles themselves are housed here at the University of Minnesota's Goldstein Gallery of Design and the Minneapolis Institute of Arts. They hold the physical objects, the textiles, and there are about 1,800 textiles in our holdings, which are cataloged and documented within each of those institutions. The third institution is the Elmer L. Anderson Library of Libraries Northwest Architectural Archives. You can see I just go over and say, show me this, please. I'm not very good at the names. But it's a very important partner in learning more about Larsen because they contain the correspondence, the paperwork, and the design maquettes that were used for all of the textiles. With the university, and this would not have, Minnesota would not have the honor of having this archive if it hadn't have been for the amazing cooperation, flexibility on a dime that the University of Minnesota and the Minneapolis Institute of Art was able to do. And I must confess that I didn't think we had a chance because we had a very narrow window and I didn't think a university could move that fast, and you guys did. And I'm so proud to be in a community that can do that. It's just quite amazing to me. Now I wanted to, here we go, my notes are bad. Otherwise I'll talk on forever if I don't hold on. There are three, the physical housing of the archive is in three different places, but there are also three major parts of the archive. It's the Department of Product and Design as opposed to the design studio. We have the product and design, which gives us insight to who the mills were that were producing these. And sometimes you would have mills that would produce the same fabric, one in Germany and some in America. And we have an insight to which fabrics there were and which weren't. We have some of the mistakes that the company made because, and they couldn't sell it because it wasn't a perfect production piece. And then we have some pieces that just didn't hit, that didn't sell. And so we were able to keep those. But that's all valuable information to give us insight, not only to the company, but to the times that it was produced. We have printed records, and they, which I mentioned, are at the Northwest Architectural Archive. And they were particularly valuable to me to give me an understanding of some of the problems that you could run into with product development. For instance, one of the Larsen's initial strength was developed in the 1950s through the production of unique casement fabrics. Those are fine fabrics that are placed over windows. They're window curtains, not draperies. Draperies block off the view. Casements still give you light, but some sense of privacy. And everybody had these new great buildings with all this glass, but all of a sudden they felt that they were living in a fishbowl. So Larsen was a great innovator with these fabrics. And some of them, a particular fabric he produced, which was a bestseller, everything was going along fine, and we all know how important resource development is to get the right materials to make whatever you're making. What happens in the middle, not the middle of your production, but you've got it all done, it's marketing, it's going like hot fire, and some manufacturer tells you, we don't make that thread anymore. And reading this literature, reading the correspondence between the then head of the design studio and various manufacturers was really painful. It took her 6 months to find a thread. And meanwhile, people are saying, where is my fabric? I need it. And so it gave you a really human look at what the archive, of what the company went through. Other things that I hadn't realized were so important to a company were government regulations. What happens when a new customs duty is put on that if you have a textile with more than 33% cotton in it, the custom fee is exponentially expanded? And so designers had, and it was something I hadn't thought about, you design beautiful textiles, you get whatever it takes to make them beautiful. But all of a sudden you have this economic component of a government regulation that you have relatively little control over, and they suddenly put it on. So you have to start bouncing around to compensate for that. And then there's the sense of sudden changes of world events. There's a fabric in the exhibition called Chimu, which is a resist dyed velvet that was made in
that one.
Oh, good. That was made in Kenya, and you have problems like there was military actions in the African, off the coast of East Africa, and there was an Italian ship bringing velvet to Kenya to be dyed, but it couldn't land any place for 6 months. When it finally landed, all the fabric was mildewed and couldn't be used. So these are some of the things that happen that you as a business have to compensate for, but you have no control of. Another thing too that Larsen was innovative for and that you see highlighted in the archive is their work with many small producers. It's much easier to have 96 fabrics made from one mill that's a really good mill and a really good producer. But Larsen traveled extensively throughout the world and would find innovative textile producers produced on a very small level. The amount of material that they could turn out in the way they were producing things was small. Also, they didn't quite understand the need for consistent standards. But he was willing to work with these people, and I remember talking to him, and part of this information is in the archives, which not only contains the original material that Colfax and Fowler's American subsidiary, Cowton and Tout, generously gave to the University of Minnesota and the Minneapolis Institute of Arts, but it indicated the, we also created a series of interviews, and so those are also now part of the archive. And through those interviews, I had talked to Jack about how, because through my research, I have worked with a number of ethnic textile producers, and saying, well, you know, for instance, I had just come back from work in Morocco, and I said, there's some great things there. He said, yes, we had somebody once in Morocco, but you needed a contact person there who understood the American production needs and could communicate and work with the producer, because I had noticed the embroiderers in Morocco did beautiful work, but if they had a coffee stain on it, it wasn't much of a deal. It didn't matter too much, and their customers could accept that. An American customer, you can imagine, isn't going to be too happy if you've paid a considerable amount of money for a wonderful textile and it's got a coffee stain in the middle. You'd like to make your own coffee stains. Okay. So I'm giving you these examples. I have given you these examples tonight to know how much you can learn from the archive, and that you learn not only about the company itself, you can apply those same lessons to the other producers at the time and see how innovative Larsen really was, and also it helped me understand older textile production from 1,000 years ago, because I started asking questions about sourcing, about government regulations, about warfare. So I want to compliment the University of Minnesota for allowing us to be able to have this archive and to be able to use it, and to the students in the audience to take advantage of it, because you'll learn so much more than you originally thought you were going to. Thank you.
I'm going to pop up there because I want to see what's behind me.
So, for those of you clever, that's my mom. So I have a quite unique relationship with Jack Larsen in that.
That's cute.
Did you not see that?
That's so cute.
So, as the daughter of a textile curator, I grew up here in Minneapolis looking at textiles and seeing fabrics all around. And most 10-year-olds don't have a favorite designer, but I did, and it was Jack. And part of that came from the evolution of going with my mom to seeing things and seeing something that interested me. And my personal background was the question of how did they make that? How did they do that? And a lot of things, it's quite straightforward, and the beauty may be in the surface, but a lot of Jack's things, I don't know how they made that. How did they make those yarns do that thing? Or I remember one specifically that was printed on the warp, so the threads that are like held taut on the loom are printed before the weft goes in. So you have a color underneath that's not a pattern, then you have a pattern on the top, and then that pattern was printed with a bleach, so all of the color was removed in some areas. So the number of processes and the number of steps in the Larsen fabrics, it wasn't just one thing. It was you know, a tie-dye in Africa, a saran wrap woven in Brooklyn. It was all sorts of different things that were really interesting and intriguing to me. So when I was in 10th grade at Minneapolis South High, I had to write a paper on an American. And instead of choosing George Washington or Carnegie, I chose Jack Larsen. And my teacher was very concerned that I wouldn't have enough source material because she had never heard of Jack Larsen. And I wrote to the design studio, and they sent me a packet of articles and magazines and just tons of stuff. So I had my many original sources. So I was kind of a devotee way before I ever studied textiles at university. And then when I finished at university and I went to work for Jack, which was like my epitome of my dream come true. So I am here with Jack at like 23 years old. That's the background. This is me in the design studio at Larsen. And you can see actually on the right-hand side of the top corner is the fabric that's in the main entrance of the museum up there in the exhibition upstairs. And it was woven for the first time on that loom. And Jack, at that, in this particular circumstance, it's woven in Thailand. And Jack handed me a cone of yarn that was linen, and the mill had previously only done silks. And he said, now they're willing to weave linens. Here's some linen, do some samples. So these are various samples that were woven, and we would hang them up.
Oops. It'll come back.
Oops, there's me at my desk with some colors in front of me. So the process of working was very mixed, because sometimes you started on the loom, sometimes you started with a sample that came in from a mill, sometimes you started with an idea. Jack once handed me a photograph of a inlaid wooden cabinet and was like, this is interesting, do something with it, you know. So the design process in the studio was very fun, because you really got to explore things from many different directions. There's a shot of the studio at the time, the way we would hang things up on the wall and see how they worked together in colorways and see a big piece. One of the things that was extremely reassuring to me as a young student coming into the Larsen studio, which I had kind of thought was like nirvana, and a sample would come in and would, you know, it's like, is this the right one? Is it good? And Jack would be like, I don't know. Let's put it on the, you know, lie it over the sofa. And then we'd stand back and they're like, let's wait a couple days. Like, and we'd come back and look at it again. And then Jack would say, blow it up 20% and shrink it 20%. And then we would do those two versions and then put them on the sofa and walk back and live with them for a little bit. And so seeing them in place or hanging, I think I have some hanging at the window. So all of those are different colorways of a certain, I think that's called city blocks. And they're little pieces of silk woven in linen. And we weren't sure what color would look best. And a fabric that's on the table and a fabric that's at the window does not look the same. And so we would hang them up there and then leave them and kind of go through the evolution, ever so I'm gonna pull one down, that's definitely not the right one, pull that one down, and you know. We had lots of interns in the Larsen Design Studio, always, and we had fun. So you can see actually that colorway of the pink one never made it. but it was a very international place. We had a lot of students from Germany, a lot of students from the Royal College, a lot of KG is from Japan and went on to work for Accompany Nuno in Japan, and now currently has his own company in Tokyo. So I often say that everyone in the industry worked at Larsen at one time, because there's the amount of influence that Larsen has had in the industry spreading out into all the other companies. Everyone has a Jack story. This is a picture of me at home making a quilt, because when we would create a fabric, and this one is one that Lori designed, and it's called I Ching, and we would create perhaps 200 colors of a fabric, and then we would pick 8 of them to introduce them. And this is from that process of living with them and looking at, well, the 192 fabrics that didn't get introduced often went into the archives that we used from the studio, because if a special somebody wanted to do a hotel and they wanted 800 yards, 800 would be great, wouldn't it? They wanted a big order, but they didn't see a color that would work for them in the colors that we had introduced. Could they make a custom? We might have it in the archives. So the archives were really a living tool that we used. We would go call down to the warehouse, bring up the I Ching box. Some of them I hijacked, though, and made into quilts at home. These are more samples on the wall. This is, again, another Lori collection, mostly. Is Lori, right?
Yeah, it's Paradigm.
It's Paradigm, yeah. So the way that we would lay out the colors to work, and you would want a color of one fabric to be able to sink into a color of another fabric. You wouldn't want one red to be totally different than another red so that they couldn't sit together. So it's very important that the group of the collection to be able to be used together. That's Lori and I at the Paradigm introduction. So we had a good time. That's me in the fabrics. That's the warehouse. And so that's how it looked of where all the fabrics were kept, and they had labels on them of where they came from in the mill and how many yards were on each roll. And then every time they would pull a roll out, they would, you know, on December 2nd, they cut 5 yards off for this purchase order number, so now the total number on the roll is X minus 5. So this is the warehouse, and it was there were areas of casements, and there were areas of upholsteries, and they think they were by number rather than alphabet, but they were all organized so you could go down and see where the fabrics were. And also in the warehouse were boxes and boxes of the archives. This is Jack and I presenting a collection at Longhouse, and I will share with you that the outfit I'm wearing, I made from a Larsen window fabric. And so I'm wearing Larsen, presenting Larsen with Jack. And at this particular sales conference, do you remember?
Yes.
Jack insisted that everybody at the sales conference only wore white. And all of us were in white, and it created, and this was just one example of the aura that it created to be part of the Larsen family and to be part of the Larsen community, because you felt like you were connected to something, and seeing everybody out there, and nobody contrasted with the fabrics, and he was very, the whole presentation was really important to how it worked. So the next segment is slightly different, slightly stepping away from me personal, but I have slides from 2 different experiences, because the thing that I kind of touched on early was the diversity of the Larsen fabrics. And you can see it upstairs, how so many different techniques, so many different styles, so many different materials were all brought together. Some of them hand-woven, and some of them extremely high tech. And this is at a mill that I visited in Thailand, And so we would have to go to these places, and when you're there and you're seeing what the possibilities are and you're working with the people, you can say, oh, wait a minute, could you do this? Or, oh, I've never seen this kind of thinking. So you have a much more hands-on feeling of what's actually happening. These are women sorting the silk cocoons that were produced. They had the like big trays of worms that would eat the mulberries, and then the cocoons would get formed. They would boil the cocoons, then they would sort the cocoons. This is a woman also in Thailand setting up a loom. This is the printing in Thailand that was actually screen printing like you would do in the design studios here, of moving the screen down the cloth. These are the looms in the Thai thing where you're just rows upon looms. This is a mill in Japan where there were barely any people. And it was, you can see a big vat of fabric going into a tube, and what happened in there then happened, and then it came out. Mm-hmm. So the total opposite effect of where you're seeing every step along the way, there were really high-tech situations too. These are in Japan as well, the dyeing vats, the way they would dye things. And some of the fabrics that we have in Japan, that we have from Japan, are 100% polyester, and they're what's called piece dyed. So they're dyed as a huge piece of fabric. The yarns are not dyed before they're woven. But if it's all polyester and it's piece dyed, you kind of wonder, how do you get different colors? Because those of you that know kind of dyeing things, if you're dyeing something and part of the fiber is linen and part of it is cotton, they're going to absorb the dye differently, but variations of the same, because those are both cellulose. If you're dyeing something that's wool and cotton, you can have a much greater difference because wool is protein and cotton is cellulose, and you can get a higher difference. 100% polyester, there are different types of polyester, so you can cross-dye that. So knowing what is possible, getting into the details and the gritty bits of things was fun. This is it's a catch, because a lot of the textile design process happened like this. When you're sitting at a table with some business people and they have scissors and a fabric and they're like, look, this is what the machine does. It cuts it. And so to contrast sitting at the loom in the earlier picture, when you're sitting at a loom or you're painting at a table, you're also sitting across an office table and discussing what is possible and how could it be done, and then complementing it later with color and adding it to pattern. And that's in Japan as well. And I'm not exactly sure what's going on there, but I thought it was really cool. Yeah. So that's at the Larsen Showroom. So Lori, I'm leading into Ellie. I don't know if I do. I still have time, or should I?
Okay,
keep on talking.
Please do.
So the design studio for me was such a special place because you crossed between. We would go to the showroom and we would talk with the showroom staff and help them understand the processes of the fabrics. But then we would also go to the warehouse and talk to the warehouse staff of what problems they had with the fabrics. And I guess kind of tying it back to the archives, for me, working at Larsen, the way the archives worked was Gmail, in the sense that we all, when we forget something, that, oh, I had a letter from somebody, and you type into Google, or in your Gmail, you can search for anything in your history. But when all your correspondence is starting with telexes and faxes, you don't have that opportunity. And so Jack would say, I remember Chimu, and we did it in a green color, and I think that color would be good for this. So I would go to the files and find Chimu. I've never heard of Chimu. Okay, so I'm gonna go look up Chimu, pull that out, call down to the warehouse, can you bring up the roll of Chimu? They bring it up to the design studio, we lay it out, we'd see a green, and we're like, oh wow, that is a cool green. That's fabric is from 1958. I'm just making that up. I don't know when Chimu came. But that kind of concept of having the breadth of history. I came at the very end, not the very end, because Larsen is still continuing, but the very end of working with Jack in the studio. And so that memory that was contained in the archives. And then you'd go to the file and you'd see who you corresponded with last, and then you'd get the number out of the archives, and then you'd write a letter to that person, can you still do this type of production? And hope they answered back. And so that kind of using the archives, we did use them constantly in the studio as a filing system and an access to the history of the breadth of the company in that way. So that's my presentation. And Ellie.
So should I sit here?
Sit whatever.
I don't know. I'll sit and maybe get up. First of all, let me tell you how excited I am to be here in Minneapolis celebrating Jack Lenor Larsen at 90 and celebrating his unique and marvelous contribution to the world of design. Thank you, too, to Stephanie Zollinger and the University of Minnesota for organizing this panel discussion and for including me. I'm so happy that the University of Minnesota and the Minneapolis Institute of Arts have put in such great effort in preserving Jack's works, because I think it's an absolute treasure. I really do. It not only gives us a window into the history of a very special time in the interior design industry in this country, but it can also be an inspiration for designers and artists of the future. So, because I think we'll be talking at length about Larsen textiles and designs and so on and so forth, I thought I'd give you a little bit of background about Larsen, the company. It was a company that created a culture from where the designs originated and from where they went into the world. I began my career with Larsen in 1972 when I was hired to be the secretary assistant to Frank Huggins, who was then the national sales director and vice president of sales. I had just arrived in New York with a BA in English and not much else. I met Frank socially through a childhood school friend of mine, and we liked each other instantly. And very shortly after I met him, he said, "You're going to work for me." Sounded good to me. I was flattered, and I thought working for him and for, as he described it, the most exciting and influential company ever, sounded like fun. I'll tell you right now, I had never heard of Jack Larsen. I did not know the first thing about interior design, but my lessons started as soon as I started working there. The company was like no other company I had ever worked for. It was exciting. The people were so nice and so knowledgeable. The fabrics were so beautiful, and everyone took time to sit down with me and explain what they did and how the company worked and how it all came to be and all that. They also told me lots of stories about Jack Larsen, who I was just learning was a pretty big deal in design. Because he was traveling when I started work, I didn't meet Jack for several weeks. By that time, I'd heard so many stories about him, I was absolutely petrified. Because he was already a living legend, you know. So when I finally did meet him, I sort of said, "Oh, I'm so excited to be working for you, Mr. Larsen, da 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 da." And he looked at me and said, "Call me Jack." Turned and walked away. And that was how I started my career of 23 years with Jack Larsen, some of the best years of my life. That first year was my total immersion into textile and interior design. I loved every moment of it. And I have to tell you, I was the envy of all of my friends because I adored going to work every single morning. And I stayed late every night because it was so much fun. It was never boring. As part of my introduction to the firm, Frank had me spend 3 weeks in each of the major departments, the design studio, the sample department, the showroom, and of course, customer service. It was the best training I could possibly ever have. After 9 months, Frank came to me and said, there's an opening in the outside sales in the Larsen showroom in New York. He thought I was up for the challenge. I wasn't quite sure of that, but I thought, what have I got to lose? So of course, my very first client that I called on in outside sales was the prestigious firm of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill. Let me say I was terrified. I thought I would be a total failure. But I found out that the preparation that I had had as Frank's assistant, working with all the aspects of the company, from the design studio to sampling to talking to the salesmen and women in the field, really prepared me and gave me the knowledge and confidence to answer the questions posed to me by the designers with whom I was working. I have to tell you, I fell in love with sales. I just adored it. It was so wonderful to be able to provide my clients with these special designs that suited their needs so well. I felt like it was a calling, and that's when I stopped thinking of this as a job, but I really started thinking of it as a career. The people with whom I worked became more than colleagues. They became family. And to this day, whenever
we still are.
Yes, whenever we Larsenites get together, like members of some elite club, we reminisce about the good old days. We remember our favorite collections, designs, opening parties, and often find ourselves playing name that fabric. I continued happily working in outside sales in the New York showroom until 1981, when Jack asked me to open up a showroom for him in Seattle, his hometown. Although I really didn't want to move so far away from New York, it was another great opportunity, and it brought me some of my happiest moments. I fell in love with Seattle and was made vice president of sales there. In 1984, I was asked to move to Chicago to become the Midwest Regional Sales Director and oversee the renovation of the Larsen showroom in the Merchandise Mart. By 1989, I had come back to New York as the National Sales Director, coming full circle to where I began with the firm. In the 23 years I was with Larsen, the company grew and evolved, opening its showrooms across the country and the world, but it always retained its family spirit. It was always innovative and always a leader in the industry. There were always fresh, young, talented faces working with the Larsen Design Studio and working with Jack and producing fabulous designs. The legacy of Larsen, the company, is due primarily to the quality of its designs, but I believe the prevailing culture of education was so crucial too in making the company a success. Jack and his design team created stories with each new collection. Each had a theme, each had a history, and each one had new or ancient techniques that Jack would explain to all of his staff in detail in his presentations. In this way, he educated us as to the possibilities of usage. We'd pass around the new designs and we'd ooh and ah and all that, but we'd also learn the story that Jack told, how things were made, why certain yarns were used, what the suitable uses were for the fabrics, and what testing had been done. In turn, we salespeople would go out to our clients with the new collection and the new story. We'd educate them as to how the fabrics were made and how they might be used. Our clients, in turn, got inspired and excited and would give us other innovative ways of how the fabrics could be used. So they'd be educating us. It was kind of a big brown circle. And then they'd go out to their clients and talk about Jack and talk about how these things were designed and manufactured and get their clients excited. So it was a constant circle of education. Jack's legacy was, of course, his great designs, how he took old techniques and used them in novel and updated ways, how he used modern industrial yarns in ways previously unheard of to create supple and graceful textiles, how he created such amazing designs that their existence created a need for them. But Jack's legacy, in my opinion, did not stop with design. I think he was a master marketing genius, And to this day, I think he is. He's just phenomenal. Always surrounding himself with talented people who loved and appreciated what he was doing and who helped his dreams become a reality. His designs were fabulous. His opening parties were grand. He created a niche for the unusual, the exotic, and the forward thinking. We just helped to spread the word. So thank you to Jack.
So happy to be here. So in the mid-80s, now I always hate telling this part because people know how old I am, but I got out of college. I was a textile design major at Syracuse, and I did all these crazy contemporary hand painting on silks, but the market was super traditional here in America. And I had a job at Fieldcrest designing little flowers for bedding, and it just wasn't really what I wanted to do. The only person that was doing anything interesting and innovative was Jack Larsen in the US. I tried to meet him so many times, never got an appointment. Finally, I gave up on America and I went to Europe. And I started to make my way there, selling designs for all kinds of use, but mostly for textile. And then got homesick, quite honestly. I didn't fall in love with the Italian that I had hoped to fall in love with, so I came back to America. And a magazine article came out with one of my designs that I'd done for a Swiss company featured next to Jack's. So I wrote it out in the magazine and I sent a letter. Dear Mr. Larsen, as you can see, I'm next to you in print on this occasion. I would like the opportunity to be next to you in person. And I got a call 2 days later from his secretary, Crystal. And she said, Mr. Larsen, we'll see you. And it was the big day in my life. And for any textile designer, Jack Larsen is it. And here I was, and I got all dressed up, and I brought my portfolio, and we sat together, and we had this lovely meeting, and he looked at all of my designs, my hand-painted silks, and we talked and had tea. And he said at the end, very nice to meet you. And that was it. There's nothing else. There was no other. So that was kind of that. And then I went back and decided I'm just going to build my own studio. I'm not going back to a Fieldcrest. And I started to create all these other things that involved pattern and color. I was designing packaging for Estee Lauder, and I was doing dinnerware for Dansk and all this stuff. And all of a sudden came a call from Jack Larsen. And he wanted me to come in because he was looking for a design director. Oh my God. Design director of Larsen is a dream come true for any textile designer. But I had spent the last 4 years building my own design studio where I was doing all these cool things. What do I do? And I was really torn about it. I had also heard that as amazing as it is, it's also really challenging to work there. And Jack can be brutal. Honest, probably 99% of the time correct, but brutal. I talked to a friend at lunch and she said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, if I could do anything, I want to work part-time, I want to blah, 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 blah. And they said, just go ask for it. Go for what you want, not what you think is possible. Oh, okay. I went in to see Jack, and he can be quite intimidating. And he's sitting at his big desk, his big, long, white desk, and he does have a habit of chewing on fiber. And he's sitting there, chewing on fiber, just looking at me. And I have a tendency to talk and talk and talk. And I'm like, Jack, this is what I want to do. I want to work part-time for you. I want to do autonomous collections. I want the collections to have my name on them, which was something that hadn't happened in the past. And I want advertising with my name. And I want to travel the country with your national sales manager and do trunk shows. And I went on and on and on. And my upper lip is sweating because that's what happens when I'm nervous. And he's just sitting there chewing on the yarn. And finally, I just ran out of things to say, and I go, and he just looked at me, and I will never forget this moment. And he said, that sounds fine, Lori. So, I got to do my thing, which was unbelievable, with Jack Larsen, and he left me kind of do it without him hovering, which was amazing. And my job there was to bring an energy that could complement Jack's aesthetic, but be a little bit different. It was a time where we needed a little something new, a little refresher, but it had to be Larsen still. It had to relate to Larsen. It had to be all the things that you've heard about and that the company was about, but something fresh and different. So the first collection came out, and it was a hit, and it was called Simply Grand. And it was simply grand, not just the collection, but the whole experience. And Jack was so behind me in supporting this, and I'll never forget it. And here's some of the examples of products that we came out with. So we used a lot of the techniques that Jack had used for years. The same mills all over it. He sent me all over Europe, which was fantastic. And but the patterning was a little bit different. I was a painter by training, not a weaver. He was a weaver. He used to say, "Lori, Lori." He really does talk like that. He said, "We approach things completely differently. I look at the detail first. I look at the construction and the weave, and then I build from there. You think of the big picture painting or pattern, and then you decide what you're going to do with it." He was absolutely right. So we actually made a really good complement to each other. And because of that, we were able to bring some new things, fresh things to the market that did quite well. And I just like to show some of these examples of them actually in spaces, what interior designers did with their magic to use these products. Solace is a cut velvet that to this date, I believe, is one of the best selling from this particular mill in France. And Jacob's Ladder, which might still be in the line, I'm not sure, was a pleated velvet that we figured out over a long period of time how to actually make so that the pleating wouldn't come out when you upholstered with it. That's that. So what is Larsen? What was the brand? And how was I going to bring something? I really had to think about that. And when I walked through the exhibition today, I remarked to Krista about this. What's so amazing is that it is a brand that you know it's Larsen, and yet he could span the most traditional patterning and the most contemporary patterning, handmade and tech, all at the same time in one piece or all in different pieces, but something about each piece still resonated as a Larsen. That is not easy to do. In fact, I don't know many companies nowadays who can do that the way he did. Also from Simply Grand, we worked with silk and linen. And this was a discharge print on a linen velvet. And for the first collection, we decided we needed to make a big show. As Ellie said, there were some great parties. And we decided to have a famous hat designer create hats out of the new fabrics. And then we auctioned them off for charity. And Jack, because he knew everybody in New York society, invited 10 luminaries to model them. And when we auctioned them, it went to Housing Works, which is still around and a wonderful charity. And Jack was, of course, one of the models. Mary McFadden was one of the difficult ones because she didn't like what we asked her to do, so she did it her way. But these people were so generous. Whatever Jack asked for, people said yes. You could never say no to Jack. I wish I bought this one and had it. I don't know who ended up with it. And then we continued to do 5 collections together. And it was really a lovely experience. And here are just some other examples. This was from Paradigm, which Krista worked on with me. That was using all these elements, but this is the one I really want to highlight. And it's the one that maybe is least known, but the fact that a company that was in business to make money with Jack Larsen at the helm allowed this was quite incredible. I wanted to do something different. I've always been fascinated by music as an inspiration for visual. And Jack allowed me to work with his friend, Jacques D'Amboise, who's the head of National Dance Institute, to work with children from inner city schools in Manhattan for a week, playing different kinds of music and having them design patterns to the music. We labeled every single painting. We had jazz, we had blues, we had Aboriginal music. And what I wanted to do was prove that you could visually resonate from music and be inspired by. So this is just one day. We had a week of this. And then we went back to the studio, taking some of these patterns, like this painting here, and creating a textile and a royalty of all the sales of this collection went back to the National Dance Institute and these amazing inner city school kids. And what I want to really say about this project is inviting the kids back a year later to show them these fabrics. They were really excited because they thought they were going to do the project again, and I was going to play them crazy music, and they were going to paint. But all we did was show them their fabrics, thinking they'd be so excited to see their product actually living in a textile. And they didn't care. Because what they cared about was the process. The process. And I think what is part or most of the magic, as we keep talking about this theme of family and, you know, and education and aesthetics, but is the process by which everything was done was beautiful. It started authentically and it ended authentically. And if by chance or coincidence the fabric sold, great, but that was never the goal or the criteria. It was in a way after. I mean, Ellie might have a different opinion about that. But when you don't have that, and that's all Jack, because nowadays it isn't so easy. It's sort of about that bottom number, and that does limit creativity. And this was just an article that came out a few years back in Interior Design Magazine, where they did a story on mentors and then people who, and Jack is absolutely number one mentor for me. And it was comparing products that he's done that I've done and how showing how inspired I have been by him all these years. Thank you.
Thank you. So now I'd like to open the floor up for questions. I know that there's lots of questions out there that you want to ask. Yes.
I'm wondering what made Jack interested in starting the textile industry.
Can I say a really good quote from Jack that explains that? He was an architect, or studied architecture.
Right.
Yes.
I don't know if he ever got the degree in architecture,
but he said something to me, and I don't know if it went public, that I loved. And he said textile design was the perfect blending between architecture, painting, and poetry. And I've always loved that because I think that's really accurate. And in architecture school, he fell in love with things that were not so static. Mm-hmm. That helps.
I think it also, and maybe Ellie can correct me here, that it was through ethnographic textiles that he had to do a special study when he was an undergraduate student and found some Peruvian textiles that kind of fascinated him. And from the engineering aspect of architecture, he then looked at the engineering aspect of Peruvian textiles, which will blow your mind of the diversity of what's happening. So if you come from nothing and suddenly start on that, you know the world is limitless in what you can do. So I think that's some of the elements that happened. He didn't wake up one day and said, okay, I'm going to be a weaver. It kind of worked through.
Next question.
Yes. How many people and how much time would you estimate takes to create one design of a fabric, like on average? Because I always thought it was just one designer in a room who just painted.
Totally
and
not.
Painted.
I would say one number that's interesting to think about is when we're doing a collection, you usually think of a year. So in terms of number, I mean, I don't know if that's still, you would agree with that. So one person may make the original painting, and like Jack's, or I thought that Lori's point was particularly good of like, she sees things from the overall feeling and image first and then goes in, and Jack starts small and goes out. And for me, Lori hired me at Larsen And I started with 50% of my time for Lori and 50% of my time for Jack, which was like the best thing that could possibly happen because I had both teachers working in opposite directions, but not in conflict. Like it was just the greatest way to see how both of those work. So there some fabrics are like very quick and some are totally not. But there is the mill and there are designers at the mill that are working on a fabric. So, you know, Lori and I are working on a fabric now in which we'll come up with a concept and drawing and send it to the mill and say, can you give us an interpretation? And then they'll give us back something back and we'll say, okay, I like this part, I don't like that part, can you change this part? We send it back. So that designer at the mill is working on it as well. And then everyone in the studio has some degree of input, and the top of the studio has the greatest degree of input. But I don't know, it's not a specific number, but.
Yeah. I sat with Jack at the his birthday party, at the opening, and started talking about various countries, and kind of got the impression that he was a traveler first, because I started talking about Korea and that I had been researching in Korea. And he said, well, I really love Korea, but it was too expensive. And so I got the sense that he went there and looked at the situation and then kind of made his decisions rather than going or thinking about a concept and then going and finding where it might land in what country. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I would say that's accurate. There's a lot of serendipity. If he would meet somebody and that person had spent time in Thailand, and then he would say, oh, on my next trip to Thailand, I'll be sure to meet up with you, and that kind of thing. And a lot of people also, as Larsen started to gain a reputation, mills would call up and say, can we come and show you our product? And so I would say 30% of my job at Larsen was mill meetings. And then the mills would come every, at least annually, usually twice a year. These are the new fabrics that we've been working on. And so you would pull samples in the same way at a showroom, interior designers will go and pull samples. We would pull samples from the mill of different techniques they've created or different yarns that they now can access or different things in that way. So a lot of times a design will start from something that a mill has done that you see potential in something else.
Good questions. In the back.
For the designers, a question. What do you think of the aesthetic success or impact of digital printing, and what do you think Jack thinks of it?
Do you want to take it? I can answer Jack later, but or do you want?
You go ahead.
Well, so when I was in the studio with Jack, is always interested in new techniques. So there's nothing that there, you know, that kind of futuristic, oh, that's the tradition is spoiled by the new thing. He's never going to do that. Anything that's new and that's interesting, he will go towards. And when I was in the studio, so, you know, I left the studio in 99, but the company was sold, so Jack left, I think, in 97. So I'm talking early 90s of digital print, and we were working on digital prints, and we could not get color consistency. So we actually had a really awesome fab product idea, and at that time, I mean, now you see it kind of all over, but we had photographs of flowers from a photographer friend of Jack, because Jack knows everybody and will pull things in, and so we had a layout of really beautiful flowers, and then we asked it to be digitally printed, and we'd get a sample, and we'd kind of say, this part is too red, and this part is too green, and we'd get another sample, and it was totally different. They couldn't control the color. And so we worked on that for months, and it never was introduced, and we never went anywhere with it. So I don't think Jack would reject digital print. We couldn't introduce it before 97. Now, it's a totally different story. Lori has digital prints in her collection, and Do you want to talk to the future of digital prints?
Well, I think if, you know, there's a big happy future in digital prints, I think that the challenges and what Jack would be up for as a challenge is how to make them different and layered and innovative and interesting in the same way you were describing before. Like, it wasn't enough for Jack to just, you know, print on the whole fabric. He'd print the warp, weave the weft with the solid, and then do a resist. And I think the same would apply for digital print. I know that for me now, in my collection, I absolutely want to do something to make it more unusual and to give it more leveling and dimension. The beauty and interesting part about Larsen, and I went through this when I was there, was any of this, the very straightforward prints, whether it was, at that time, I guess, mostly screen printing or rotary, was it was never quite enough to be a Larsen. We had to do something to it to make it a little bit more unique and special. But I know that Jack would very much rise to the occasion and find ways.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
You know, I want to make one addition to this, which is interesting. Because of Jack's persona and reputation, it was not only him rising to the occasion, the mills, even large mills, but also the small production people would try innovative things and saying, he used to talk about, at one time Larsen owned a small mill in New Jersey, and the weaver there, it was a mechanical looms that they were using, and Jack would say, well, let's see, couldn't we make this a little irregular? And the fellow would consistently say, no, can't be done, why don't you use your head? And then he said, within about 48 hours, he'd get a call and say, well, I've been thinking about this, and maybe we can do this. And so he would inspire other people to push their limits and work in the thing. And that was quite remarkable.
I think today, if Jack were still working, he'd be very excited about smart textiles. And he'd be working with things that light up or change color, totally. But make them beautiful. Marilyn, did you?
Well, I was first introduced to Jack Lenor Larsen in high school. I found a book on Jack Lenor Larsen and was fascinated all my life. And one of the things that has fascinated me about him is how contemporary things look. I mean, when you look at the dates on the textiles in the exhibit space, and you think about today, they still look contemporary and very much up to date. And it must be this complexity that you're talking about that makes the sort of
timeless.
I think also, though, very much too, I think it was you that said he didn't make it for the market.
No.
He made it for his creative exploration, and then the market followed him. He was definitely not responding to the latest color trend and then running after it kind of thing. He created beautiful things, and then other people recognized the beautiful thing. So I think that is what the longevity of it. And I used to joke, my like tagline in coming out of college was, I don't do enough drugs to be a fashion designer because it changes too fast in the things. And at Larsen, you're designing textiles for a sofa that would last for 10, 20 years. People now change their sofas every 5, but definitely at that time, you went for durability. And Jack often says that fabrics would, when there was a great concern for hyper durability, and they would go 50,000 rubs and 100,000 rubs, and he would say that fabrics would ugly out before they wore out. Because that if a fabric was like lasting forever, it would just be ugly and there's no holes in it. But if there was like a rip or a hole in it and it was still beautiful.
I'd like to add a point for those of yours particularly doing design right now. I don't know the company as these three did who worked in it. I know it from the archives, and frequently they were on the border edge of bankruptcy. And with the attitude, and so there was always this balance of, we want creative vision and we have to do this, but we also have to make a living. There was some of that, and there were some stock items that were successful, and and I like the combination that they hit as they brought in a few more business people and a new president of the company, where he said, I don't want to interfere with the designers, but you have to produce fewer textiles, and a few of them have to be really good sellers, and then after that. Mm-hmm. But it is interesting, one of the sales rep, Mark, what was his? In Chicago.
In Chicago?
The rug guy.
The carpet guy. Mark, what's his name?
Well, Weitzner. Anyway,
Mark Weitzner. One of the people at the Chicago office, the Chicago showroom, told me the story of Magnum, which is in the exhibit and in the back of the gallery, the reverse.
It's embroidery on mylar, squares on a metallic background with embroidery around
which it. Which was a special order done for the Phoenix Opera Curtain, and it was so fabulous. They made it in different color waves, and many of the showrooms had it in there in a prominent place, and the head of the showroom in Chicago told me the story. He said, we had millions of, or we had hundreds of people come in because they saw that fabric. It never sold a yard.
This is Magnum.
But it brought, but it brought people in. And so you have some kind of fabrics and some that are financial losers, but in the big picture, add some. So you can see.
It's in the MoMA and it's in the Met. Mm-hmm. It's
and it's know. Here.
And it's here.
Yeah. And this, what I'm trying to say is there's so many facets again to making things work. And that they would take chances is fantastic, but it couldn't be all chance.
What was the office environment like when you were working with them? Like, how did Jack interact with everyone, and how did you guys interact with each other?
Jack was very intimidating.
Yeah.
And I think that people, except for like Ellie, were nervous when he was around. And I think the energy did change when he wasn't around and he was traveling.
Mm-hmm.
And people were more loosey-goosey and more comfortable. And when he walked into the studio, you know, we kind of wanted to hide what we were working. We sat up and we kind of wanted, if we weren't ready yet for him to see something we were working on, we were kind of like, didn't want him to, you know, we were trying to hide it. And, but I say that in a loving way, you know, like he was who he was, and he was intimidating, but he was also a visionary, and as I said before, brutally honest, but amazingly so. I mean, he could, we would have everything on the wall, and he would just go to this one thing and say, that color is too brown, or something like that. And you'd be so annoyed because you work so hard on all of this, and he's talking about this. And then he'd leave, and you'd look at this, and you'd be like, he's right. So
he could always, there was always, he could find a criticism. Like, he could find something wrong with it. And so, and not so often would he come in and say, oh, great job.
I don't know,
beautiful.
Ever.
Like, yeah, never. Yeah.
No, so, seriously, so, but like, you got used to it, but you were always kind of wanting him to,
but
you
it,
wanted his approval.
It made us all raise our game.
Absolutely.
Because he cared enough to be focusing on every detail. I remember a specific, I was doing a sales presentation of a new collection, and it was in a hotel room. It was like in a, not in a bedroom of a hotel room, but it was in a hotel. And we were there early in the morning and getting the presentation ready. And we were like, that piece of furniture will disturb the view of this space. And so we had to like move that out of the way. And can we bring plants in? And they were like, what can we do about the chandelier? Can we cover the chandelier? Can we like cut, like there was nothing, but it made all the presentations better. And it made like every, you were tight on your game because you needed to be, and it mattered. But aside from Jack, when Jack walked in, everyone sat up and you went into his office and you were like, you know, you listened and it mattered. But it's so true. There was such a family atmosphere of all the other people. You know, the Christmas parties were all potluck, and we were all so excited to be there. And we knew all of each other's lives, and it was a very warm community.
And sometimes I'd be angry at Jack because of something, And then the next day there would be a pot of paper whites from his garden on my desk.
True.
He would just do these things without any, you know,
right.
It wasn't contrived and it wasn't planned. I mean, he would, and then of course I couldn't be mad at him anymore. he was, and just really quick, funny, that just happened is I wrote a book and he's in my book, he has a page in my book, and I was so excited to bring it to him, and I brought lunch and I brought him the book, and a week later I get a letter from him. Lori, this, you're such a scholar, this book is so wonderful, blah blah blah, and I'm reading it like not believing that he's actually complimenting me, and then the next paragraph says, but you really need to cut your hair. He said, you look too much like, if I can say, I don't want to get political, but you look too much like the Trump ladies, and you need a new bob. And I read this, I brought this home, and I said, Mike, to my husband, look at this, from Jack. And he says, you do need to cut your hair. He's always right.
Other questions? Yes.
Can you tell us what you eat you're doing now?
Well, I'm happily retired. So I've been retired now for 6 years, and I'm just traveling and enjoying my life.
I'm doing the same thing, and just as both Ellie and I were talking this morning, just relishing the extraordinary quality of the ordinary. It's just, I never had the time to sit and look at the birds drink water or whatever. I always wondered why people would make patios in their house. Whoever had time to sit in a patio anyway? And I use my patio morning, noon, and night. Not now.
Well, so. One of the things, when I traveled for Larsen, of course I would go to all these different cities, but I never got to see the cities. You know, I'd be going, you know, from the showroom to the client's office or whatever. And so I said, one of these days, when I retire, I'm going to go back and see the city. So this is, Minneapolis is one of those cities, so I'm enjoying myself thoroughly. Thank you.
I have a design studio in my home in Brooklyn, and I do projects for, I'll do custom carpets for people. I have a loom that is in my studio, and so I do weaving projects. I work at Lori's studio, on special projects, which is awesome to be able to work with her. And I am renovating a house on the side, so.
And I have a design studio in New York, and I also started, after Larsen, a wall covering and fabric company, and try and continue on and continue every day to be grateful for Jack, because one of the big parts of the work that I do is working with artisans around the world, in Nepal, in Thailand, in Japan, in the Philippines, in the US, and try and kind of in my own way do what he did, which was find a way to work with artisanal product but make it commercially viable so that we can pay the rent and pay our employees. And so he's kind, and I have a framed piece of Magnum in my design studio as an ode to Jack. And so the future is there, and I think textiles is a very exciting career path. And I think there's a lot of new interesting things happening, and I think that one of the reasons why the future is so bright is because of all the hard work and travel and genius that Jack did so many years ago. So I highly recommend textile design as a profession, highly. We're happy people.
Well, and I think that today the word globalization has kind of become a bad word in certain contexts of use, but Jack was the best of globalization, of creating product all over the world and bringing it back and leaving access for us to product that was, you know, done in Japan and France and Peru and everywhere.
So, any last minute questions? One more, yeah.
For you to answer, including Lotus, what is the one greatest impact that Jack Lenor Larsen had on your career, the one who
Well, like Marilyn, I can't remember kind of when I didn't think Jack was like bigger than life, and I don't remember a book, I don't remember any particular influence, but somehow I knew about him and that he made beautiful things, and I like textiles, and sort of that played into that. I have to confess that at the Minneapolis Institute of Arts, I wanted to collect his work for a long time. And of course, we never had any money to buy textiles. And someone said that, oh, you could write him and he would possibly donate some, and because some it could be a tax deduction, or he was also very generous to various educational institutions, mm-hmm. which I consider the museum to be an educational institution. And I will have to tell you that I wrote the letter, I slaved over it, and it took me 4 years before I could send it. And when I did send it, he was very generous, and he gave us 12 textiles in 1984. And that started the relationship, and part of why Krista began to see more Larsen textiles around.
Mine is so easy and so huge, obviously. But growing up in the world of the museum and in the world of arts and crafts in Minneapolis, and I knew that that was what I loved to do. And I also, myself growing up, seeing the fine artists in textiles in Minneapolis, the number of people that are involved in that and doing beautiful things, I got exposure to that through my mom. But except for Tim Harding, every single one of those people creating beautiful textile fine arts had a day job. And so it was very important to me to grow up and be financially independent. I didn't want to grow up and be a waitress that wove in the evenings. I wanted to be able to have a job that would support me. And so Jack Larsen gave me a job, and I was able to support myself doing what I loved, and that is pretty huge.
And as I said, I didn't know what I was going to do with my BA in English, you know. I was overqualified for any position I applied for when I first came to New York, and underqualified for a lot of other things, so I just was, you know, at wit's end as to what was I going to do with it. I didn't want to teach, and so by this circumstance of meeting Frank Huggins and getting into work for Larsen, it just was like an awakening. It was like magic, you know, and it inspired me to try to get more involved in design and find out more about it. It was just a magical, magical thing. And I honestly never thought of it as work. It really was just fun, and it became my career. I mean, it was my career, so I have to thank Jack for that.
I think the thing that most influenced me, if I had to say one, was I learned about taking old and maybe even ancient techniques and creating them in new ways, or taking everyday materials and doing something unique with them. That's one of the big things I learned from Jack.
Great question.
Yes, I'm Ellen Wells, and there is an earlier story to what you're presenting. My gallery was Textile Arts International, and before that I was an interior designer at Dayton's. This is Tina Hatch, my office mate, and this is Susan Lowry, and we've been friends since yesterday, right?
Yesterday.
And when I, after doing interiors, I was teaching interior design, and then I went to open my gallery on Mount Curve in Minneapolis in 1980. And Susan was a rep for Jack Lenor Larsen.
Oh, wow.
And Susan said, Ellen, what would you think of showing Jack Lenor Larsen in your gallery? And Now, this is one of the mansions on Mount Curve, walnut paneling, high ceilings, and so that Jack was in an environment in an art gallery, a textile art gallery. And then she said, it would bring you wonderful visibility. And I thought, that's brilliant. So we did that, and one of the interior designers was Gary Hovda, and I was showing both, I was showing fiber artists, but I had, when I was teaching, I had come across two women who had master's degrees and were using computers to weave or to do their quilting. Agam was the gentleman who was changing the light and such. And so it was these two women who were my inspiration, along with some Hmong refugees who were, you know, very highly visible. And Gary Wolfde chose to use some commissions and textiles for the Hyatt Hotel at that time. So her concept of bringing interiors, interior designers to the art gallery was brilliant. Susan goes on to represent another company, and I get married and I move out of my gallery, and I thought, here is the new rep for Jack Lenor Larsen, Wendy Witt Johnson, and Wendy comes, and she moves into my gallery.
She used to work.
And Lotus Stack comes to see my exhibitions, and she brings her daughter. And so here are the seeds.
Thank you for starting.
Yes.
These are the seeds that are planted, and it's so exciting to hear what has been developed. But the visionary
is there.
You know, the story just goes to show how amazing things start in small ways. Mm-hmm. A conversation between two colleagues and building up something where a young person can actually touch and feel and really examine an object, you know, as opposed to, it's pretty difficult in a museum or in this environment. And those of you who are students here who can actually use the archive itself as a teaching tool, it's invaluable. And it's important. Everybody here has indicated on the panel, and I think with great truth, that they were impacted in some dramatic or dynamic way that they've taken and moved forward by Jack Larsen. And this conversation here with people whose names will never be on plaques, maybe Ellen's will, she did a really a lot of work here. But some of the rest of you who were involved in these things kept it alive, made it happen. So it's just, as Lori, as I think it must be your motto now, and I haven't got it quite down, but don't do, aim for what you want, not what you think is possible. And get those ideas out and try mixing things. And it's amazing what can happen. And it may take 50 years for it to happen. Which is a little longer than when you might desire. I would hope things would happen sooner, but it's pretty gratifying to see it going on. And I think Stephanie and I, who are so involved in the archive itself, hope that the archive will take and energize future people working in it, and from my experience, in an incredible variety of ways, not just how to make the flower look a little different.
Well, thank you so much for coming this evening, and let's give a hand to our panelists. If you didn't have a chance to see the exhibition, it is up.